Hey everyone, today's guest is Dave Pirner, lead vocalist and guitarist for the Minneapolis, Minnesota rock band, Soul Asylum. Together we take an inside look into the writing, recording, and inspiration behind the hit single, Somebody to Shove, the lead-off track from their 1992 album, Grave Dancers Union. We've heard this numerous times here on Krista Makes a Podcast, and it still amazes me each time. But Somebody to Shove was written in the 11th hour, after the writing sessions for the album were already completed. Dave brought the chord arrangement and an early basic lyric idea into the studio one day to show the band, and when producer Michael Beinhorn heard it, he immediately said, "This has to go on the album." Not only did it go on the album, it was the first song on the record and the first single from the album released to radio. I asked Dave if he double-tracked his vocals on the song, and he honestly couldn't remember, chalking it up to something that Andy Wallace probably tweaked when he mixed the song. And this is the first song we've broken down to date that has pulled lyrical inspiration from a nursing home, a landline telephone, and a box of Cracker Jacks. Pretty strange and pretty cool. For all this and a whole lot more, stick around.
Hey, hey, have you heard? Krista Makes a Podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Krista Makes a Podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Krista Makes a Podcast. Hey, hey, have you heard? Krista Makes a Podcast.
Hey, Dave, how are you?
Not too bad. How are you, Chris?
I am fantastic. It's a pleasure to talk to you. I appreciate you sitting in with us today. And, you know, as I was researching this episode, what a storied career Soul Asylum has. Mm-hmm. You guys began in 1981 in Minneapolis. And Minneapolis, of course, is home to some of my favorite bands. I'm sure yours as well. Husker Du, The Replacements, which you have history with both of those bands, as Bob Mould produced some of your early records. And, of course, Tommy Stinson from Replacements played bass with you guys from 2005 to 2012. But, you know, I first became aware of you guys in 1988 when you released Hang Time. And Hang Time was your first for A&M Records. And I kind of feel like you guys were kind of the last crop of bands that were actually given what was called then developmental deals, where you were able to build a fan base. You know, by the time my band got signed in 1995, you know, we got two records on Capitol. We didn't have a hit, and we were kind of out of the door at that point. So talk a little bit about that, because you made a couple records, Hang Time in 88, which had some amazing songs, Marionette, A Little Too Clean, and then you follow that up in 1990 with And the Horse They Rode In On. And by that time, you know, those records both sold modestly. By the time you were going to record Grave Dancers Union, where did you sit with A&M? Were you guys worried about getting dropped? Was this a make it or break it record for you guys?
Was it a make it or break it record? No.
I guess what I'm asking is, did you feel any pressure at that point? Did an A&R guide or anybody tell you, hey, this record has to have a hit, which how do you write a hit? No one knows, you know, it's just something that usually just happens.
Oddly enough, it was something that never really happened until, I don't know if it ever really happened. I think part of the reason why the band was interesting to A&M is because we had already developed our own fan base by constant touring. I don't remember pressure. Anyways, by the time we got to A&M, we already pretty much had a touring itinerary or whatever you call it. And they were very hands-off. And I think that was part of the understanding, is that we already did things the way we do things, and we must be doing something right. And they had no concept of what was going on in the quote unquote punk rock scene. So I think that was part of what was attractive about the band, is that we had already done all the legwork by the time the Twin Tone A&M thing. And we also, I don't even know how much reality there was to it, but it was put out on Twin Tone / A&M, which made me more comfortable. I think it made us all feel more comfortable. So it was kind of this thing where we still had our indie record label name attached to us, and we were going out into the world to wanted to try to figure out what this major label deal was all about. They had no idea what to do with us.
Well, yeah, because when And the Horse They Rode It On came out in 1990, that's before the word alternative was just starting to get uttered then, you know? And of course, it was a year later that, I hate the term, but grunge broke. So you guys were kind of in the middle there. So when this record was being written, I mean, I guess the next thing I want to know is, how did you get in contact with Michael Beinhorn, who produced the record? Because he was kind of an unknown at this point.
What we usually did was... we'd get a bunch of cassettes. Each producer would have it like their reel, you know. So I remember Michael's cassette had, this was the first time I'd gotten a, I don't know if you call that a demo reel, but his songs were edited. So he had, you know, the Chili Peppers and a bunch of bands on there, but it was only like the beginning and the middle of the end of each song. Which was a pretty good strategy, because it just kind of, it gave you a sort of overview of all the things he had worked on at that point. And then the next step would be, and I just liked the way that his stuff sounded compared to whoever else I was listening to or whoever else was being considered. And it just sounded better to me. So... next thing you do is, you know, I don't remember. I probably interviewed with a handful of other producers. And his conversation with me was, I guess you do the listen to a bunch of reels, and then you do the phone call. And then if you're still leaning in that direction, you do, you know, lunch or dinner. But he came prepared. Like he knew all the names of the songs, and he had something to say about each one. Yeah, he made a really good case for why we should work with him.
The reason I brought him up was because I was talking about that term alternative before, and you know, prior to you guys, he was working with, as you said, the Chili Peppers. He produced Fab Five Freddy, Violent Femmes. You know, Violent Femmes and Chili Peppers were considered alternative back in the 80s. And I remember hearing Grave Dancers Union just being impressed, so impressed by the production. It sounded awesome. And one of my favorite bands is from Canada. They were on A&M at the time, called the Doughboys. I'm sure you know those guys. And and I wished so bad. I was like, why can't these guys work with Michael Beinhorn? Because they put out what I considered Crush, a hit record. It just had really, really flat production on that. But the song we're going to talk about today, Somebody to Shove, was the first single that was released on May 5th of 1992. And do you remember writing Somebody to Shove?
I do. I remember the waiting by the phone bit was the part that I had first. And that was kind of one of those things that was gnawing at me a little bit, you know. And we hung out in New York a lot. And a good friend had a laminating machine. So there was this laminate that was Grandpa from the Beatles movies. You know, there's a character named Grandpa. I don't even, it's Help or something. I think it's the right movie. And some reason that triggered the grandfather thing. Yes, he was known as Grandfather. And that's kind of where the first line came from, Grandfather and the grandfather clock and all that. So I kind of slowly came together, I suppose. And I know that it was the very last song we recorded for the record. It was a situation where, you know, we had decided on all the songs that were going to go on the record. And then Sterling Campbell came in and played on the record. And when I heard Sterling play drums, I was moved. I was actually moved to tears on one song. I can't remember if anybody said, "You got anything else, Dave?" Or if I went, "I think I got something else," because I got excited when Sterling started playing. And I'm like, oh, I want to hear how he plays this idea that's been swimming around in my head, which was Somebody to Shove. So it was kind of almost an afterthought. And I believe we played through it once and Beinhard immediately liked it. I pretty distinctly remember him going, "That's going on the record." And that was a good feeling, you know.
That's really cool to hear, because I can't tell you how many times I've heard that on this show where it's the 11th hour and it's almost like the pressure's off you. You already got a record in the can. The record's ready to go. But hey, let me just try this one idea out. And then everyone jumps on it. And then, of course, it ends up becoming the first single of the record. So this was essentially written for Grave Dancers Union. This wasn't something you had held over from a previous record or something you had laying around.
Correct. Glad I thought to record it.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, maybe, I don't know. What do you think of this one?
And so do you recall at that point, did you have most of the arrangement and chords done? Where was the lyrics at? Did you kind of finish the lyrics when you were in the studio, or did you come in with that grandfather idea?
Ooh, that's a good question. I don't know. I bet you there was probably a couple mumbles in there that I hadn't quite figured out exactly what I was going to say, but I definitely had most of it figured out by that time. But yeah, that's a good question. I'm not positive if I had every single word together the first time we recorded the song. And gosh, I bet we did two or three takes at the most. Once it became apparent that it was going to be a player on the record, I don't know if that's the right expression, be included on the record, I don't remember struggling with the words, so they must have been somewhere really close, or else I would remember a moment of panic in New York City where I'm like, oh God, I got this song everybody's excited about, and I can't figure the words out. So thankfully that is not a memory, because I've had situations like that, which are not great.
And I'm assuming there's no demo of this song. It was so new that you just showed it in the studio and that was it, right?
You are correct. Yes.
Yeah, because sometimes we like to include the demos, or I'll scour YouTube for a demo, and I looked and I couldn't find one for this one.
This is the first time I've actually tried to remember this stuff.
Well, I'm asking you to have a recall of 31 years at this point, so I appreciate you. What you are recalling. And it's so funny when I get guests on here, like, man, you know, it's amazing what they do remember. But I want to jump into the track, Dave. The song is 3 minutes and 15 seconds. The intro is this killer guitar lick for two bars. Almost sounds like a tube screamer, like a little flange on there or something. It's a killer tone. And then the whole band kicks in for four measures, bass, drums, and stereo guitars, as we enter verse number one. Grandfather watches the grandfather clock, and the phone hasn't rang for so long. And the time flies by like a vulture in the sky. Suddenly he breaks into song. What's going on there?
I think I was sort of honing in on the old man sitting in a nursing home, or the old man being extremely lonely, and he is waiting for someone to call. Doesn't seem very specific. A call from his kids or his kids' kids or something, or waiting for maybe a nurse to bring him his medication. I'm not sure. I'm pretty sure he just wants to talk to somebody. And it seemed like an interesting place to start the song. And a premonition that I suppose at one point or another, everyone's going to, well, not everyone, but people get old. And it was probably like a Simpsons episode. I remember when a phone rings and all these old people come out of their rooms, and then it's it's for one person and everybody goes back into their rooms and that's their day.
Do you recall that intro lick that that I talked about? Was that something that that you kind of had kicking around when you were writing it, or is something that was created in the studio? Because it's just so catchy right off the top.
It was something that I had been kind of working on, and I think I was going, God, it really needs something to happen before the band comes in. And I don't know. I think for some reason it evokes Robert Fripp to me. It's just got this, you know, it's got this thing going on that a kind of a syncopated thing. There's this record called The League of Gentlemen, and it has these really cool Robert Fripp sort of syncopated circular bits that he's playing that are I don't know, they're just cool. So I think I was just kind of messing around with that idea. Part of the lick is something that developed out of a thing I was doing just for like finger coordination. I don't know if I learned it from I think I took one guitar lesson from this woman on the West Bank, which is the University of Minnesota. And she said, well, here's a good warm up or whatever. She was a jazz player, I think. Oh, she's a blues player. And it's kind of in there, but, you know, I don't know. I sort of developed it out of pulling pieces of not knowing what I'm doing and putting them all together.
I definitely get that, because I've been warming up before and stumbled across something. I was like, wow, that's kind of cool. So I totally get that. And kind of the reason I was setting the episode up early on and talking about where you guys came from, it's just like, listening back, I don't remember thinking this at the time, but listening back to this verse, you know, it has that feel, that early 90s, but that wasn't something that you guys just all of a sudden tried to fit into. You were doing that back in the 80s. This was your sound from when I first discovered you in 88 on Hang Time. So it just happened to be that your time kind of arrived. You guys were given enough chances by A&M where you could finally have a hit record. And I think that's so cool. In verse one here, the drums break down to just kick drum, toms, and snare. And do you recall if that's a hi-hat keeping time there, or is that a shaker going on in that verse? I couldn't tell.
Watches the grandfather clock, and the phone hasn't rang for so long.
That is a hi-hat to my recollection.
The mix is great, but it's mixed just perfectly right where I couldn't actually tell. And the stereo guitars here are, they're kind of chugging along to that drum pattern. And then we get into pre-chorus one. And I wrote here in my notes, Dave, that this pre-chorus is a chorus. It's so catchy. It's like you get two choruses in this song.
I'm waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone. Waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone.
I'm waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone. I'm waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone.
It's so strange saying things that make you sound dated, but this was before everyone had phones on them.
Yeah.
So I guess if I think about it, it's like you don't have to wait by a phone anymore because your phone's always on you. So
that's so funny that you say that, because I, to this day, like right now in present time, 2022, I don't take that lyric. I still wait by the phone sometimes, my cell phone, when someone's going to call me. So I never would have thought about what you just said. That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember precisely where the phone was in the apartment that I would wait by. And phones were a different kind of animal to me anyways. It wasn't always on you. So if you're on the road, or if you're touring in Germany or something, you got to get to a phone. yeah, it was just a different kind of thing. It wasn't always available. And you'd have to go sit somewhere and wait for a phone to ring.
Sure, sure. Did you ever have DJs or fans come up, or the casual fans say, hey, you're going to play the Waiting by the Phone song? Because again, this sounds like a chorus. You know, later on you get the somebody to shove refrain, but this in and of itself, pre-chorus, is just so catchy.
Yeah, well, like I was saying, that was the part that came first. So in a way, I was building out from around that part. Yeah, it is kind of interesting that I was like, man, it needs one more part. But I think if you listen to the records before that record, the A&M records, I guess, there's lots of parts. Mm-hmm. All the songs, part. So it wasn't unusual for me to just keep adding parts to songs. Theoretically, someone will go, that's enough parts.
Yeah. Well, this arrangement on this song is really cool. And here on the pre-chorus one, it's essentially a double pre-chorus here. The drums break away from that tom, kick, and snare beat that they're doing in the verse. They come in with a straight beat, and they're joined by strumming, stereo guitars, bass. And it sounds like an overdubbed arpeggio on the higher strings there. Was that an overdub, or was that done on one of the stereos? I couldn't really tell.
I don't recall. I mean, if there's a... So you're saying it sounds like there's a guitar, an octave up, doing the same thing?
Well, no, it's kind of like a little jangly thing there in the pre-chorus.
12 string in there or something? I don't know.
Waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone.
Yeah, it's cool, and it's hard to tell if it's one of the stereos kind of doing it while they're playing, or if it's an overdub. But I love that part. And the other thing I wanted to ask you here: do you recall double tracking your vocals?
I don't recall doubling things. Like if you listen to the twin tone stuff, sometimes Bob Mould had a thing where he'd just go put another one on there, and you end mm-hmm. up with this, you know, this kind of wall of guitars. And there's at least one song on Made to Be Broken where I took it kind of too far, and it's got a double vocal. So the song called Ain't That Tough, it's got a double vocal, but it doesn't match up, and I thought that was really cool. And I think the reason I thought that was cool is because Lou Reed does it on Street Hassle.
Oh, how I need it, baby. Come on, baby. I need you, baby. Oh, please don't slip away.
So I didn't think there was anything weird about it. But now I would listen to it and go, that's, what was I thinking, you know?
Who mixed the song? Who mixed Gravedancers Union?
Andy Wallace.
So Andy mixed it. Okay. Yeah. So I wonder if there was a chance that Andy had, you know, maybe had a couple of different takes and he was mixing in, because I swear it sounds doubled in the verses and the pre-chorus here.
I'm sure it is. I mean...
Yeah, yeah. And that's something the mixers would do, you know?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes I'd double something and not even realize I was...
That's what I'm saying. I've had that happen before.
Michael was very articulate about following through, which was not something that every producer does, but he would come to the studio when Andy was mixing, and he had notes on everything, so he could have been going, put a double in there or something. But I do recall at one point Andy Wallace turned and looked at Michael Beinhorn and went, look, man, you got all these notes on every single song. And if we're going to get through this, you know, we gotta be less detailed, or you got to back off a little bit, or I'm never finished with this, which was sort of touching to me. I was like, right on. Michael really cares, you know.
Runaway train.
Yeah,
Don't run away, because we got lots more with Dave Pirner after a few words from our sponsors. Do you like to laugh, geek out on music, and learn all about that band or artist who had that one song back in the day, but then seemed to fall off the face of the earth? If so, you need to subscribe to One Hit Thunder. Together with an array of interesting and hilarious guests, we do a weekly dive into one-hit wonders like Eiffel 65's Blue, Krayshawn's Gucci Gucci, EMF's Unbelievable, Delamitri's Roll to Me, Los Del Rio's Macarena, Musical Youth's Pass the Dutchie, and even Patrick Swayze's She's Like the Wind. So are you subscribed to One Hit Thunder or what? As Desiree would say, you gotta be. And as K7 would encourage, you gotta come baby come and join in on the fun of the One Hit Thunder podcast. Hey everybody, it's Chris DeMakes, the podcast producer, Chris Fafalius here. Once again, to share a little clip from an episode of The After Party. The After Party is our weekly podcast that we release to members of our supporting cast. If you're interested in joining our supporting cast, just head over to chrisdemakes.com. For a few bucks a month, you'll get a bonus episode each week, a giant back catalog of episodes of The After Party, and you allow us to continue making Chris DeMakes a podcast. This clip is from our episode titled Iconic Synth Riffs of the 80s that we released back in January. Here we are talking about Joy Division's Love Will Tear Us Apart. Crazy because it's catchy and upbeat, but at the same time, it sounds really somber.
Yeah, it's got those goth qualities, you know?
It does.
As you said, the track came out in 1980. Ian Curtis was only 23 years old. The remaining members of the band went on to form New Order, which, you know, you got me thinking of another song, which was Blue Monday, released in 1983 from New Order, has another keyboard riff that's just amazing in that tune that wouldn't be the same song. But Joy Division, you kind of wonder where they would have went without Ian's suicide.
Right, right. And I thought one more thing was interesting about this song, Chris, was that I guess Ian Curtis a lot of times did play the synth in the band. Or maybe just on the recordings or whatever. He didn't play guitar. That's my point here. So another founding member of Joy Division, Bernard Sumner, he switched from guitar and played the synth when they played this live. And Ian Curtis would play guitar, but only because someone showed him how to play a D major chord. And that's just the only thing he played throughout the entire song. Thought that was pretty interesting.
Yeah, I've never heard that story. That's pretty cool.
To hear the rest of our iconic synth riffs of the 80s episode, as well as a ton of other episodes, plus a new episode each week, head over to chrisdemakes.com and join our supporting cast. Your support allows us to continue making this show. So thanks, everybody.
Can you help me remember how to smile? Make it somehow all seem worthwhile.
Now, back to the show.
Well, and you were talking about the example of Lou Reed and vocals kind of not lining up. And we're going to get to that in the end of the song, which I think is great. And of course, this record was recorded analog. There was no Pro Tools or anything fixing anything here. So you can hear those push and pulls and those little rubs that you just sometimes don't find in today's music. I think it's great. So, immediately after pre-chorus one, which I'm calling a double pre-chorus because it happens two times there, we go into verse two.
Hello, speak up. Is there somebody there? These hang-ups are getting me down. In a world frozen over with overexposure, let's talk it over. Let's go out and paint the town.
Hello, speak up. Is there anybody there? These hang-ups are getting me down. In a world frozen over with overexposure, let's talk it over. Let's go out and paint the town.
Again, the communication thing was a little bit, it was just different. You know, there was busy signals and there was all these other kind of
call waiting.
Call waiting, yes. And just kind of, you know, not knowing what you were going to get when you make a phone call. And I think that can be construed as I'm waiting or whoever else who is being called, or I'm waiting on the other line for somebody on the other line to pick up. There was a bit of more of a mystery to what was going on when you got on the phone. You certainly couldn't do things like this, Chris.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, and I'll tell you what I've always loved about this song is I liked the imagery, and I never really knew what you were saying in the verses. But I liked that they were kind of obscure. And then you get into the pre-chorus and the chorus, and those lyrics are pretty straightforward, you know, and you can read kind of into whatever you want with that. And I liked the dichotomy of that within this song. Verse two, the drums break down again to that kick drum floor and snare drum thing you get there. And then we go into pre-chorus two.
I'm waiting by the phone.
Just one time you say, I'm waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone. So it's half as long. And I wrote here in my notes that it's a cool little fake out here. I love that it only happens that one. And I remember thinking back in the day when I first heard the song that was really, really good songwriting, because it jumps right into chorus number one.
'Cause I want somebody to shove. I need somebody to shove. I want somebody to shove me.
'Cause I want somebody to shove. I need somebody to shove. I want somebody to shove me.
Well, not to digress, but I thought the double entendre of these hang-ups are getting me down. It's, you know, it's like hanging up a phone, but you also have hang-ups. I'm so clever sometimes, Chris, I gotta tell you. But anyways, moving on to the chorus, I think that the punk rock movement there's this dichotomy between like absolute apathy and kind of go out and do it yourself and all this kind of youthful energy, for lack of a better expression. That sounded pretty corny, but so yeah, there was always this kind of, I don't care, I'm not going to do anything, I'm not, you know, screw the establishment. Can I say fuck?
You can say it all day
all
long.
That kind of stuff. You know, on one hand, it's that thing where it's just like, fuck everything. And then on the other hand, it's like you need a little push every now and then to keep you just believing in what you're doing. So I think if you throw a mosh pit into that, you kind of have this sort of pushing and shoving of a situation that is ultimately a positive. So yeah, there's a lot of pushing and shoving going on, but hopefully it's going in the right direction, I suppose.
Well, again, no matter what you're really alluding to there, I mean, the way you sang this, you know, with the conviction you did, I mean, who can't get behind that lyric, especially in the angsty early 90s? I mean, I want somebody to shove. I mean, that's just kind of gets people fired up. In the chorus here, the bass, drums, and stereo guitars are all in, but there's no like high part like in the pre-chorus. There's nothing else. It's kind of just straightforward. There's no harmonies in this song up to this point either. It's pretty bare, but it just sounds real. That's the term I'm going to use. After chorus one, we get into a, I don't know what you call this part, Dave, an 8-bar guitar solo, a bridge without vocals, or a musical interlude, but there is a guitar solo during this 8-bar part. The bass sounds killer here during this part. The bass run is just awesome. And the guitar solo that's happening here is reminiscent of the sound in the intro guitar lick. And then we get into verse three. The simplicity of the pre-chorus and the chorus, and now you come back with verse three. This is probably my favorite verse in the song. You're a dream for insomniacs, prize in the cracker jacks. All the difference in the world is just a call away.
First of all, I'm a terrible, terrible insomniac. So that's just kind of biographical. I've always had a problem with it. And to this day, I don't know what's wrong with me. I can't go to sleep at night. So in essence, you know, the dream is is the payoff somehow.
Yeah, I think that's the lyric I love the most. You're a dream for insomniacs. Well, insomniacs don't dream because they don't fall asleep.
Once again, Mr. Clever over here. I hadn't really thought about it for a while, but Cracker Jacks were a big part of my touring life. It seems a little childish, but you know, you're in a van constantly and you're touring constantly. And once again, to date myself, Cracker Jacks came in a cardboard box, which they no longer do. And the prizes were way better than they are now. They were a little piece, like I had a collection of colored magnifying glasses. They were these round little plastic magnifying glasses, and they came in different colors, and I started collecting them. So it's kind of strange for me to think that, you know, this little plastic thing inside a box of Cracker Jacks was, you know, the highlight of my day or something, you know.
Well, I mean, you know, touring around in a van, especially back in the 80s, no cell phones, no social media, disconnected from the world, any type of creature comfort that we could find, you know, you would do, you know. Yeah. So I think that's cool that made it into the lyrics. What I love about this verse is the drums are playing a straight beat here. They don't go back to that kick, tom, and snare thing that they're doing in verse one and verse two. And the guitars here, interestingly enough, they play a similar chugging part as verse one and verse two, even though the drums are going straight. I like how the guitars kind of kept in that world. That's really cool how that happened. We go into pre-chorus three.
And I'm waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone. Yes, I'm waiting by the phone. I'm waiting for you to call me. Don't call me and tell me I'm not alone.
Lyric is, and I'm waiting by the phone, waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone. Yes, I'm waiting by the phone. I'm waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone. And it's back to the double pre-chorus here. Again, the arrangement of this song's really, really cool. Get the double pre-chorus here. On the last line, there's an overdub vocal on the line, I'm waiting for you to call me up and tell me I'm not alone, that doesn't line up what we were talking about earlier, like that Lou Reed thing. And I'm hearing the first vocal harmonies in the song here, although they fluctuate between being harmonies and unison with the melody. They kind of go back and forth. Do you recall doing that part in the studio? Was that something, a suggestion that Michael Beinhard had, or did you just get up in front of the mic and just start kind of riffing vocally?
If I had to guess, it was probably some combination of those things you just mentioned.
Yeah.
I probably did it a couple different ways, and they, I don't know whose idea that was, but you know, my guitar player, Dan Murphy, was there and he did a background vocal, which it probably happened pretty organically, I guess, is what I'm getting.
Okay. So that wasn't you on the other vocal. That's Dan.
I honestly don't remember.
Okay. it sounded like you there, but again, what's going on? It's semi-loose, but it even gets looser.
Because I want somebody to show up. I need somebody to show up.
I want somebody to shove. I need somebody to shove. I want somebody to shove me. Yes, I want somebody to shove. I need somebody to shove. I want somebody to shove me. And it's really interesting how this all comes together here, because it continues with those unison vocals with sporadic harmonies, some of which are odd note choices. And I love those notes. It adds to the tension here, but yet it feels loose as the vocals aren't lined up super tight in the back half here. Again, was that something that just kind of happened in the studio? Do you remember doing different takes of that, or did it just kind of come organically?
I think that's me just kind of messing around with different ideas. And sometimes I just pile on harmonies because I was sort of experimenting. I'm guessing that that's what was going on there. I was just messing around with the gotta have something new going on here, or something a little bit different. And, here comes the harmony, and let me try this and let me try that. And things, a couple of things were, you know, different phrasing and timing. And I'm sure that's probably what happened. So it's probably just a combination of hits and misses and, you know, just
yeah.
What will work.
Chorus two is the only double chorus in the song, because there's only two choruses, chorus one and then the chorus two, but you get three pre-choruses, which again, I'll make the case for that. The pre-chorus in this song is as strong as the chorus in the song. And I think that's just awesome. And I chalk it up to great songwriting. Right after chorus two, there's an 8-bar outro with the main guitar riff. We don't resolve on the B chord that after that main riff comes into the top. It goes to the B for the verses, but it ends nice and happy on that G major, and then the song is over. 3 minutes and 15 seconds goes by way faster than that. The song's just written so well, goes by very quickly. Dave, do you recall listening to the song back on the faders or hearing the first mix back, and what did you think of it after bringing the song in to the record so late in the game?
Well, usually we say playback is a bitch, but when something like that happens in the studio, it's pretty satisfying. So I do remember playing it once or twice and having Feinhorn going, that's going on the record, and standing there and listening to it and feeling pretty good. I mean, it sounded great just without the vocal, as far as I remember. We were just listening to the track. You know, it was kind of something that the record needed, kind of unbeknownst to me, or wait, beknownst to me, now that I'm thinking about it. There was one or two other songs that I think I pitched towards the very end of the record at that same time. They were more up-tempo, kind of aggressive kinds of things. So, yeah, I do remember it being this burst of energy and then this exhale of, hey, that worked, you know?
Yeah. And do you recall being stoked that not only was it the first lead-off single of the album, but it was the first track on the record? Were you surprised by that? Is that something that you guys wanted, or something that A&M was suggesting?
Now I'm trying to remember what the singles were on the A&M records and kind of how we were sort of learning what that meant.
Right. Well, you guys led off with this, and then Black Gold was the second single, and of course Runaway Train was the third track, released in June of 93, which sent the record into the stratosphere. But I guess what I was asking was were you surprised that the song you brought in so late to the game was the first single? That had to be a pretty good feeling.
I was, and it was, and it seems oddly fitting somehow that you would start with what you ended with.
Yeah.
So, I think people were excited about the song, and I welcomed that. And we certainly had never seen anything where a record label was going to stay devoted or dedicated to the band for three singles. That was kind of unheard of for us anyways. So if there was like a bigger strategy going on, we were not aware of it. We were still kind of feeling our way through what was going on. And in retrospect, it seems obvious, oh, they built it up to Runaway Train. But I don't think we certainly didn't have any unreal expectations. I think if anything, we were as surprised as anyone that people liked it. You know?
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, you guys, again, you'd been a band for 11 years when this thing hit. I don't think there was any any plan going into this. Like, it was just the next record that you guys made, and I really believe that you stuck it out long enough to where your time finally arrived. Music was ready. You know, that I don't think the 80s were ready for a band like Soul Asylum. It needed to percolate a little bit, and you guys finally hit. Before we break, is there anything you'd like to leave the listeners with? What you got going on with the band? Any tours coming up? What you got?
Most of the time in the summer, we go out for maybe a 2-month tour. It's kind of a mixed bag. So this summer, we're doing weekends. I was just trying to explain that to somebody. I mean, when you're out and you're doing 5-6 shows a week, you fall into a rhythm and the band really starts to steamroll and things become more effortless as you get used to the day-to-day of playing every night. You know, after the first week and a half, it's the parts all kind of seem to come together, and you don't always get that when you're playing weekends. You got to stay in the groove, so to speak. So we'll be, and then I'm doing some acoustic shows this summer with my guitar player, Ryan Smith. And we're kind of playing all over the place, and we'll do a week and a half here and a week and a half there. And, you know, it's different. I can't say I prefer one thing over the other, but as I was trying to tell somebody the other day, sometimes you're on tour and it's a, 2-month affair, and you end up in these parking lots, or you end up playing a dead town on a Tuesday night, or playing on a Wednesday night, someplace where you're wondering why you're there. So there's an advantage to playing on weekends, obviously. So I think that's what we'll be doing all summer. And, I'm looking forward to it. I love going out and playing. And I like a 2-month tour also, but it's grueling.
Yep, I hear you. I don't bounce back as fast as I did when I was 22. But Dave, I want to thank you for sitting in with us today. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Chris. I appreciate it too. It's fun.
There's lots more Chris DeMakes a podcast after a few words from our sponsors.
Hey there, I am Johnny Christ from Avenged Sevenfold, and I've got a podcast called Drinks with Johnny you're going to want to check out. I sit down with a bunch of different people from all different walks of life, from professional wrestlers to actors, comedians, fighters, musicians, everything in between. I'm just looking to make some friends and have a good time doing it. So if that sounds like something you're into, go check out Drinks with Johnny, streaming everywhere now.
Hey, everybody. If you like Chris DeMakes a podcast, I'm going to assume that you like music podcasts. And if you like music podcasts, check out One Hit Thunder. Each week, we dive into a one-hit wonder, and along the way, we gain some knowledge and have some laughs. Lou Bega, Crazy Town, Harvey Danger, The New Radicals, Aha. We're over 100 episodes in now, and to paraphrase the great Matthew Wilder, nothing's going to break our stride. Subscribe to One Hit Thunder wherever you get your pods.
As we near the end of the show, here's a band you might not know.
Welcome to this week's Band You Might Not Know. If you'd like your band to be considered for Chris DeMakes a podcast, all you have to do is email your best song via MP3 only and bio to bandyoumightnotknow@gmail.com. This week's featured artist is Skapository from New York City. Their most recent record is appropriately titled Up Yours. You can find their music on all the streaming platforms. Here's a snippet of their song, Are You Rude Too?
Silence, man, with a face to be scared. My heart is racing as I look in the rear view. Everything goes by fast. If I'm not there, now someone's happy to hold. And I scream, fuck you!
The Rap with Chris and Chris.
So, Chris, as a kid who grew up in the 90s, it is so wild and strange when we do these conversations and a person's face pops up on the screen. I'm like, oh, my God, that's Dave Pirner from Soul Asylum. It's like this surreal thing. And I'm like talking to him, and it's the people that I watched on MTV and stuff. So I thought that was pretty neat.
Yeah. You know, I remember being happy for these guys when they finally hit. As I said, I heard them sometime around Hang Time in 88. They were what you would call alternative in the 80s. They didn't really have a spot on commercial radio yet. They were ahead of their time, and they stuck it out. And then all of a sudden, right place, right time, their sound came around, and they stuck it out long enough to finally have the recognition they deserved.
That's the coolest way to do it, man. Have the world catch up to you, not try to catch up to the rest of the world. I really like that part of the story that they had put out, what do you say, five albums before signing to A&M? I think that's pretty awesome. Well, you know, somewhere in that ballpark of a bunch of albums, basically, throughout the 80s. And yeah, when it was their time, it was their time in a big way. You know, Runaway Train was obviously the really huge song, but this being the first single from that album, as soon as, you know, the publicist got in touch with us about this episode, my first thought was, man, I want to do Somebody to Shove. And we had our conversation like, oh, but Runaway Train was the bigger one. I'm like, I love Somebody to Shove. I think this is my favorite Soul Asylum song, so I'm really glad that we did this one.
Yeah, and I honestly, I don't know if the world would have heard Runaway Train if it wasn't for Somebody to Shove. You know, this song got picked up by MTV, and I think it was the right choice. I think if they would have led with the ballad, it might have fell flat. They might have not. I think they had to go with this one. I think it was the right song. And I, how many times have we heard, I even told Dave, how many times has someone went in and said, it's just an idea I'm kicking around. It's the 11th hour. The album's done. The producer's sitting there going, wait a second. What is that? Play that again. That's going on the record.
And it was a really good point about the pre-chorus being, to me, a chorus. That part is what sticks in my head. The waiting by the phone part is so catchy. But, Chris, you talked about this briefly in the episode. That lyric, you know, I want somebody to shove. I need somebody to shove. I want somebody to shove me. That concept, that lyric, it kind of sums up the 90s in my head. Yep. For some reason. It makes me think, I mean, for lack of a better way to put it, it makes me think of moshing. It makes me think of a live punk rock show, or, you know, a rock show in the 90s, and just the sort of feeling or attitude of what we'd call Gen X, I guess, at that time. This sort of like apathy, this apathetic attitude, but I want someone, I interpret it as I want someone to shove me out of that. Now, that might be me putting my own meaning into it. It could be something a lot less meaningful than that. I don't really know, but it definitely is a strong lyric and song title.
Yeah, and I had mentioned to Dave that I think I used the term angsty. You know, the early 90s were just angst and apathy, as you said, and one part anarchy you could throw in there, and just this rebellious nature, and that lyric is perfect. You know, I had mentioned that there's a simplicity to the pre-chorus, which, again, to your point, the pre-chorus happens three times. It's almost the chorus. You know, the actual chorus only happens twice, but there's a simplicity to that lyric in the pre-chorus as well as the chorus that we just talked about. But the verses, there's a lot of imagery and a lot going on there. And I like the picture that he was painting there. It's really, really interesting where he came from a lyrical standpoint.
I would have never pictured that. You know, I pictured when he was talking about like an old folks home, a bunch of people, the phone rings and they all go to it. And then it's just for one person or whatever. It's very sad. So I would have never put that sad meaning to it. And yeah, I think the verses are, I would have never known what those verses meant. I thought it was really funny that he talked about, yeah, this song kind of dates me. I'm talking about being by the phone and waiting for it to ring. Well, now you carry your phone around. But Chris, I'm like you. I didn't think of that, and I wouldn't have thought of it because, I don't know, I set my phone over there on the coffee table. And
I still wait. I still wait by the phone.
Right.
I still say, but maybe I'm dating myself. I still say that.
Well, I guess no. I would say it too. You plug your phone in to charge it. I never looked at it as being like a dated lyric.
No, not at all.
I still thought it was interesting he pointed that out because, hey, look at a lot of songs in the 90s. You're going to find dated, 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 even in the 2000s, 2010s. I mean, I'm careful not to do that now. I don't want to write a song about like I was on Instagram today. I hear people dropping the apps and names of apps and stuff all the time in songs. I'm like, let's not do that.
That'll be
obsolete, you know?
Yeah, that'll be dated real quick. And, you know, we heard it in the Huey Lewis episode, Chris, when Huey was talking about Bob Clearmountain mixing in some stuff that Huey heard later. Was like, what? You know, Bob mixed the record. And same thing here. I had said to Dave, did you double track these vocals? He's like, I don't think so. I swear they're double tracked. I can hear it. Okay. And he said, well, maybe. And I bet that was Andy Wallace. He got a couple vocals. He's like, you know what? Here's the main vocal, but I'm going to ghost this other track he did here. It kind of adds a little texture to it.
I mean, that's why you get someone awesome like Andy Wallace to mix your album, right? Give him a bunch of stuff. Let him work his magic. Give him some options. I know in my experience with Punchline in recent years where we track the stuff ourselves and then we hire a mixer and we give him the kitchen sink and be like, all right, you get to work. Do your thing to this. And I think giving him options, someone like Andy Wallace can step in there with a couple different vocals. And Chris, you were asking him about like, did you sing that? I can imagine Andy Wallace was taking parts where they were unison and mixing in the parts where it was harmonies and yeah, creating his own thing, which is kind of what Dave alluded to there.
Yeah, and good for Michael Beinhorn, too. You know, he had a good track record in the 80s. He had worked with Red Hot Chili Peppers, who were not a household name then. Herbie Hancock certainly had success, but I don't recall the record that Michael produced for him. But, you know, he worked with Fab Five Freddy and then Violent Femmes, who weren't, you know, they were a huge underground success, but not a huge commercial success. And then he did the Soul Asylum record. Next thing you know, he's doing Super Unknown by Soundgarden. And after that, he went through the stratosphere, which is really... need to see.
Yeah, that's awesome. And Chris, you talked about this a minute, but those last minute songs are sometimes the best. That's like the fifth or sixth time we've heard that now.
I know.
In this 100 and some episodes of this podcast. Hey, don't be afraid to break out that guitar. You might write Alkaline Trio Radio, or you might write Soul Asylum, Somebody to Shove. You never know, because when you're in the studio, you're in that state of mind. You're like, you're feeling creative. And Chris, you said this in the episode, but sometimes some of that, whatever pressure you were feeling about like getting this stuff done, is now lifted off your shoulders. It's kind of like, okay, I've gotten all this stuff out of me, and does it leave room to create or something within your mind, within your heart or something or does it just the creativity be sparked by the experience? Who knows? But, I would suggest anyone who plays in a band and is in a studio, don't be afraid to pick up that guitar or that bass or, you know, whatever, or just hum a melody that last couple days in the studio. You don't know what's going to come out.
That's right. And also, don't be afraid to join our supporting cast over at chrisdemakes.com.
Do not be afraid of that. Yeah, go to chrisdemakes.com. You get extra episodes. I know we're always hitting you guys with this every week. Don't be afraid of that. Don't be afraid to write a song in the 11th hour. Don't be afraid to, in the 11th hour, join the Chris DeMakes a Podcast supporting cast at chrisdemakes.com. You help support the podcast, and you get a bonus episode every week and lots of other stuff. So, yeah. Good call, Chris.
Yes, lots of other stuff, because we work this like a job because we love it. And if you haven't already, please give me a follow on Instagram at @LessThanChrisD. Want to thank this week's guest, Dave Pirner, and we'll see you next time.
Hello out there.
Yes, hello out there, everyone. I'm Hal Schwartz.
And I'm Flynn McClain. Together, we host None But the Brave, a podcast dedicated to the music and career of Bruce Springsteen.
Bruce and E Street Band are on tour right now for the first time in 6 years, and we're taking a detailed look at what's happening on stage in our bi-weekly episodes.
We've also been recently joined by some very exciting guests, including rock journalist Warren Zanes and Stephen Hyden, Backstreet's Magazine founder Charles Cross, and Barstool's Kirk Menahan.
If you're a diehard Springsteen fan, this is the show for you.
So please subscribe to None But the Brave on your favorite podcasting platform, and we hope to see you further on up the road.
Thank you so much. We'll be seeing you.
What's up, everybody? I am Finn McKenty, host of the Punk Rock NBA podcast, part of the Sound Talent Media podcast network. My podcast is all about doing what you love for a living, and every week I sit down and talk to people who have done exactly that. For example, musicians like Tommy from Between the Buried and Me, Matt from Periphery, Lil Lotus and Shinigami, among many others, photographers, artists, designers, YouTubers like Glenn Fricker and Sarah Dici, and I unpack exactly how they got to where they are today with the goal of helping you do the same. So if that sounds cool, you can listen and subscribe at soundtalentmedia.com, and I'll see you there.